Hello everyone, I am Dr. Ramesh. In this video, I am going to discuss about the introduction to lasers. Laser is very special when you compare with the ordinary light due to its special characteristics like monochromaticity, directionality, coherence and intensity. Laser is a short form of light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. In general, we are very curious to learn about different concepts like what is a laser, how we can produce the laser light, what are the necessities for to produce the laser light, and what are the different applications of laser light, and what are the precautions we have to take while operating the laser light, what are the different kinds of lasers is possible with the different materials. In this video, I'm going to cover the basic introduction to laser, stimulated emission and population inversion concept. Light amplification by stimulated emission and radiation is generally considered as laser. Here, all light is nothing but like photons, and it is amplified. That is, the signal strength is increases. Is generally called as amplification. Here, the light intensity, like a photon number, is increases. Like the intensity is increases because of the stimulated process. Now, I am going to discuss about the how the light is amplified based on the stimulated emission concepts. Coming to the history point of view, Einstein proposed the concepts of stimulated emission and the spontaneous emission in 1970. He proposed, that is, he predicted the possibility of spontaneous and stimulated emission when an atom can emit radiation. By using that concept, Charles Stoltz and Arthur of Bell Laboratories invented laser in the year of 1958. For these people in investigation, those received Nobel Prize in physics in the year of 1964. Initially, they investigated based on the microwaves, and initially it considered as major, like microwave amplification by stimulated emission and radiation, and it is, and later it is applicable to light, then it considered it as laser. And the first operational laser is developed by Maiman in the year of 1960 by using the ruby laser. Ruby laser is also considered as solid state laser. Coming to the brief introduction related to the how the light is amplifying, how the radiation interacts with the matter. What's the matter? That is, what is the meaning of matter? Matter consists of the atoms. Again, atom consists of the electrons, protons and neutrons. The protons and neutrons located in the nucleus, and electrons are revolving in different orbits around the nucleus. If electron has high amount of energy, it can vibrate or it can rotate in the higher energy level. If it has lowest energy, then it rotates in the lowest orbit. If you supply energy to the lowest orbit electron, it can jump to the higher energy level. And another thing, higher energy electron comes to the ground state by losing its energy. So in this process, any electronic transition, that is how the electrons are moving one energy level to the another energy level, every electronic transition occur in either atom or matter, that photon fall into one of the following three categories. The first one, stimulated absorption. stimulated absorption, then second one spontaneous emission, and third one stimulated emission. So the first point of view, the photon is absorbing. We know that if any electron is absorbs an amount of energy, it move to the higher energy level. And the second and third is related to the emission. That is nothing but high energy level electron comes to the ground state with release of energy in the form of photon. I'm discussing one by one. Stimulated absorption. Stimulated absorption. See, initially, if just I consider the E1, E2 are the energy levels. For the reference point of view, I consider the two energy level system, two energy levels. E1 is the ground state and E2 is the excited state. So initially, the more number of electrons are located in the ground state. If any photon is absorbed by the ground state electron, then it goes to the excited state, like a high energy state. The ground state electron absorb the photon and it moves to the excited state, like a high energy state. So then here it is three electrons, then one electron goes to the high energy state because of the photon absorption. This is called as stimulated absorption. In the equation point of view, H nu plus ground state electron, it goes to the excited state electron. The rate of absorption, that is how many electrons move to the higher level within a particular time period, is taken as a rate of absorption. That is depends upon two factor, that is how much photons are giving to the ground state atoms and how many available atoms to absorb the given photons. So these two factors decides the rate of absorption, that is energy density and the number of atoms or electrons in the ground state. This is related to the stimulated absorption. Coming to the second point, that is spontaneous emission. The meaning of spontaneous is without any time delay. Spontaneous is nothing but without any time delay. Initially, the electron is in the excited state. Electron is in the excited state. It spontaneously coming to the ground state. That is without other cell, it coming to the ground state. Then because of the emission process, it releases photon energy. That photon energy is equal to the difference amount of energy in between the levels like E2 and E1. So in the equation point of view, excited state electron comes to the ground state electron with release of the photon. And the rate of spontaneous emission, the rate of spontaneous emission, how many photons are coming, that depends upon the how many atoms or electrons available in the excited state. It never depends upon the energy density because there is no interaction takes place in the spontaneous emission. So rate of spontaneous emission depends on number of atoms or electrons in the excited state. And coming to the third one, like stimulated emission. In case of stimulated emission, here also emission, that is nothing but electron is coming from the electron or atom is coming from the high energy state to the low energy state. But here the external agent is interact with the external excited state electron or atom, then it comes to the ground state. Because of the interaction of the photon with the excited state atom or electron, it comes to the ground state with the release of the two photons. And these two photons again interact with the two more electron, four photons can be expected. So in the equation point of view, H nu, that is nothing but it's a given incident photon is interact with the excited state electron. It can able to come to the ground state with the release of the two photon. One photon is supplied, then two photons are released in the stimulated emission process. So that it means that one photon can able to generate the two can able to generate the four, then four can able to generate the eight. That it means the photon number is keep on increases, the photon number is amplifying because of this stimulated emission process. So the rate of stimulated emission depends upon two factors. Then one is the energy density and another is how many electrons or atoms are present in the excited state. And when you take in the comparison between the spontaneous emission versus stimulated emission process point of view, spontaneous emission takes place by its own without taking any external help, but stimulated emission takes place because of the external photon interaction with the excited state atoms. So because of spontaneous emission, there is no chromatic radiation, monochromatic radiation is expected because all lights can be possible, whereas in case of stimulated, only single wavelength light can be expected. Less intensity in case of spontaneous because every time we are expecting single photon is emitted, but whereas in case of stimulated point of view, we are expecting more number of photons is emitting, all are moving in the same direction with all are maintaining the coherence and they can interfere together, then the intensity can able to increase more. Spontaneous point of view, its directionality is less because divergence is more, but in case of stimulated point of view, it is very, very directional. So rate of spontaneous emission depends only on the number of excited state atoms. It never depends on the energy density. Whereas in case of stimulated, it depends upon the energy density and the excited state atoms atoms. And last one, it has a low coherence spontaneous, that is the released photons. There is no proper relation is maintained in between the emitted photons, but in case of stimulated, all the photons are maintaining the relation, that is nothing but it maintains the proper coherence between the released photons. Coming to the population inversion. Here, the population inversion, when we take in the stimulated emission process, initially one photon can able to generate the two can able to generate four, by these two photon interact with the two more atoms of the excited state, and four can able to generate the eight. So this process can be increases, but there is a limitation in that. So that limitation is population inversion. So if any material, if any system, if it maintain the population inversion, then only stimulated emission process can be possible. Without population inversion, there is no possibility of create the stimulated emission process. Without stimulated emission, there is no possibility to create the laser light. So the population inversion is one of the basic or crucial step to produce laser from any system. So the meaning of population inversion is the process of creating more number of atoms in the higher state than the ground state is called as population inversion. I'm repeating again, the process of creating more number of atoms in the higher state than the ground state is called as population inversion. In general, population is nothing but number of atoms or electrons present in a particular level. In ordinary situation, every atom wants to be settled at the ground state level. That it means that in ordinary situation, the population of the ground state is more compared to the excited or high energy system. But now what we are doing, we are creating more number of atoms in the higher state than the ground state by using any external energy. That it means we are sending energy to the ground state atoms and we are pumping that ground state atoms to the excited state. Then after certain interval of time, excited state atoms are more compared to the ground state, then the population inversion is achieved in that particular situation. Once the population inversion is achieved, there is a possibility to create this stimulated emission process. That pumping mechanism, that means how in what way we can send the ground state atoms to the excited state is called as pumping mechanism. That can be possible by giving the temperature, thermal energy, or by giving the optical energy, light energy, or by giving the electrical excitation, or by giving the inelastic collision, or in different forms we can send the ground state atoms to the excited state to create the population inversion. So in this, there is one more rule here, that is, population inversion is not possible in case of two level system, because here when we take in the two level system, I take in the two level system here, the two level system I considered it as N1 is the number of atoms in the excited state and N2 is the number of atoms in the N1 is the ground state and N2 is the excited state. So by giving external energy, some atoms can move to the excited state. So the possibility of population inversion I'm checking here. For example, each and everything, atoms distribution in different energy levels are based on the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution formula. The formula is N1 equals to N0 into exponential of minus E by KT, E1 by KT. N2 equals to N0 into exponential of minus E2 by KT. When I take in the formula like N2 by N1, N0, N0 can be cancelled together. Then finally, it gives the formula like exponential of minus E2 minus of E2 minus E1 by, sorry, these are in the brackets like it, minus of E2 minus E1 by K into T. As I keep on increasing the temperature, that is, if the temperature, generally we are expecting that as you keep on increasing the temperature, like a thermal energy supplied to the ground state, it jumps to the excited state. I'm checking that maximum situation, like I given the temperature like infinity. Even though if at the temperature is terms, take it as infinity, then exponential of what is the value? Minus exponential of minus infinity. If take it as t is, take it as infinity, 1 by infinity is take it as 0, exponential 0. Exponential 0 is take it as 1. So N2 by N1 value is 1. As we given the maximum temperature, like an infinity temperature also, we can able to create half of atoms, half of the N1 atoms can be able to send to the N2 level. More than that, if the N2 never be greater than N1 in case of two level system, whatever the form of energy you supply to the ground state atoms till infinity, there is no possibility to create more atoms in the excited state when you compare with the ground state. Because of this, two level system or two level lasers, any material two energy level system is not at all suitable for the creation of the population inversion. That it means that there is no possibility to create the stimulated emission in between the two level system. Because of this, two level system materials are not at all suitable for the consideration of the laser production. So two level system is not suggestible for the production of laser because of this. So we can create, for example, when we take in the N1 having initially 100 atoms, we can max 50 atoms can able to pump up to N2, but there is no more than 50 atoms are possible in the N2 system if you supply infinity energy to the N1 atom also. So because of this, two level system is not at all suitable. So I'm using the three level system to explain the population inversion of the laser system. Here I take in the, this is E1, the first level or ground state, and it is a metastable state system, and it is the excited state. So here E1 is taken as the first level energy level, and N1 is considered it as the number of atoms present in the first level. E2 is the energy of the metastable system or middle energy level system at second level. N2 is the number of atoms present in the second level. E3 is the energy of the third, like excited state. And N3 is the number of atoms present in the, in general, third level. So generally we take it as N1 is greater than N2 is greater than N3, because mostly most of the charge carriers are the atoms are resides in the ground state only. That is N1 is greater than N2 is greater than N3. So now by using the external energy, it may be optical or thermal or electrical or inelastic collision form. So I supplied energy in the form of H nu. That H nu is equal to the difference between the third to the first. That photon, that instant photon is absorbed by the ground state atom. Then the ground state atom jumps to the excited state. Because we supplied energy, that value is E3 minus E1. Because of this, the pumping transition, the ground state atom jumps to the excited state like a third level. Now, third level is the excited system. It has very, very low lifetime. That value is around 10 power minus 8 second. 10 power minus 8 second is the lifetime of the third level system. That means after 10 power minus 8 second, it won't be available in the third level. It comes to the other state. So E3, that is excited state level, lifetime is very, very low. Because of the lower lifetime, after 10 power minus 8 second, whatever the atom going to the third level, that can able to reside up to 10 power minus 8 second in the third level. After 10 power minus 8 second, it comes to the second level without emitting any radiation, without emitting any photon. That is called as radiation-less transition. So all the atoms comes to the second level. That is called as metastable state. When you compare with the excited state, metastable lifetime is more, then obviously metastable lifetime more because of the higher lifetime, the atoms can able to reside at the second level more time because it has the higher lifetime when you compare with the ground state. So then obviously, just check it, all the atoms are going to the excited state, but excited state lifetime is low. Then it comes to the metastable state. At a particular moment, the atoms of the ground state is less when you compare with the metastable state. Then N2 is greater than N1. At a particular instant of time, the atoms of the metastable state is more than compared to the ground state. Because of this, the population inversion is achieved in between the metastable state or the middle level to the ground level. Because of this, stimulated emission takes place in between the second level to the first level. Because of this, laser transition takes place. Laser transition is nothing but because of the population inversion, laser the transition takes place. That is, photons are emitted. The photon energy equivalence to the E2 minus E1. This stimulated emission process can be possible. Then one photon can able to interact with the one more atom of the metastable state. Then that atom comes to the ground state with the release of the two photon. Then again, two is interact with the two more atoms of the metastable state. Four can be possible. Four, eight can be possible. So this is possible till the more number of atoms are high, that is metastable atoms are high when you compare with the ground state. So if the atoms of the metastable is lower than the ground state, the laser transition stops. There is no population inversion between the E2 to E1. Because of this stimulated emission process stops, there is no laser transition is achieved. But this is a continuous process as you keep on pumping the ground state atoms to the excited state and excited state atoms reach to the metastable state. And the population inversion is possible till you are sending the ground state atoms to the excited state. So this is related to the population inversion between the three level system. So that once again, I'm repeating the three level system population. Initially, N1 is the number of atoms. Out of N1, more number of atoms are jumps to the third level because we are sending the, we are giving the energy to the first level atoms, which is energy equal to the E3 minus E1. Then there is a possibility to jump from ground state to the excited state. But excited state lifetime is very less, like 10 power minus 8 second. because of the lower lifetime, the atoms comes to the metastable state without emitting any energy. It reached to the metastable state. After a certain interval of time, the metastable popularity, like a population, is more compared to the ground state because of this laser transition is possible in between the metastable state to the ground state. So till laser transition is till population inversion is possible in between the E2 to E1, till that time the laser transition is possible. So once the population inversion is stopped between the E2 and E1, at that moment laser transition is also ceased. So this is the general theory related to the population inversion. So just I given the diagrammatic point of view. So here the population, just check the N1 value. Here the number of atoms are more because the thick diagram is extended till this, and E2 number of atoms is here, and E3 is the number of atoms here. Then obviously N1, like a number of atoms, is taken as on the x-axis, energy is taken on the y-axis to represent the E and N diagram in case of the three-level system. Here more number of atoms, and here it is the middle, and it is very, very low. So N1 is greater than N2, and N2 is greater than N1. It is the before pumping. Now I given the energy to the ground state atoms. Then these atoms are going to the excited state. But excited state lifetime is low. That because of that, it's a very, very fast. It radiation less transition takes place, fast decay, and it's settled at the second level. After a certain interval of time, just check the number of atoms in the ground state and the metastable state. Metastable state, the number of atoms is more compared to the ground state because of this population inversion is achieved. And the population inversion is achieved in between the E2 and E1, the laser transition is takes place. So this is a general diagram in between the energy versus number of atoms or electrons in three-level system before pumping and after pumping. And coming to the review point of view, a review of this lecture, generally what is the laser? So laser stands for, like, a light is amplification by stimulated emission and radiation. Laser has very high intense light when you compare with the ordinary because of the stimulated emission process. How the matter interacted with the radiation? How the matter interacted with the radiation? The radiation is interacted with the matter in three ways. One is the stimulated absorption. Second one is the spontaneous emission. Third one is the stimulated emission. In case of like a absorption point of view, the ground state atom or the electron moves to the excited state. Whereas in case of emission process, the excited state atom comes to the ground state with the release of the photon. In case of spontaneous, there is no interaction between the external energy, but whereas in case of stimulated, external photon is interact with the excited state atom. It comes to the ground state with the release of the two photons. Third one, the population inversion. The population inversion is nothing but the process of creating more atoms in the excited state or high energy level. When you compare with the ground state, is called as population inversion. Population inversion is possible by giving the pumping energy to the ground state atoms. So in what way we can send the ground state atoms to the excited state is called as pumping methods. The pumping methods may be thermal energy or electrical energy or optical energy or inelastic collision. So by using different ways, we can send the ground state atoms to the excited state. And in case of, like, a bits point of view, the concept of based on this lecture I prepared the bits, and the concept of stimulated emission was first put forward by Einstein in 1917. In lasing action, the light amplification is done. Amplification is nothing but the intensity should be increased. That is possible because of the stimulated emission, and stimulated emission depends upon the two factors. One is energy density, and second one is the number of atoms in the excited state. Fourth one, the lifetime of atoms in the excited state is normally, it's very, very low. That value is 10⁻⁸ seconds. Within 10⁻⁸ seconds, whatever the atom is located in the excited state, and with it decay to the other nearest energy level? Does the light or photons have mass? Because we are speaking related to the photon, like a photon is absorbing, photon is emitting. So is there any mass related to the photon? No, photon doesn't have any mass. Photon has energy. Generally, photon is nothing but it's a packet of energy. It is a packet of energy is considered as photon. It doesn't have any mass. Thank you for watching.